This video is the second part of the poem, The Hollow Crown, from the play Richard II, written by William Shakespeare. It's prepared and presented by R. Flora Sahaya Miri, PG Assistant English at Government Higher Secondary School, Kaulpalayam, Perambalur. I hope you have watched the first part of the poem where I have dealt with the dramatist William Shakespeare, the play Richard II, and the background of the poem. Here I am going to paraphrase the poem in parts. First, let me read the whole poem. The Hollow Crown. Let's talk of graves, of worms and epitaphs. Make dust o'er paper and with rainy eyes. Write sorrow on the bosom of the earth. Let's choose executors and talk of wills. And yet not so, for what can we bequeath? Say our deposed bodies to the ground, our lands, our lives, and all our boiling brooks. And nothing can we call our own but death, and that small model of the barren earth, which serves as paste and cart o'er bones. For God's sake, let's sit upon the ground, and tell sad stories of the death of kings, how some have been deposed, some slain in war, some haunted by the ghosts they have deposed, some poisoned by their wives, some sleeping killed, all murdered. For within the hollow crown that rounds the mortal temples of a king, keeps death his court, and there the antic sits, scoffing his state and grinning at his palm, allowing him a breath, a little scene. To Manoches, be feared and kill with looks, infusing him with self and vain conceit, as if this flesh which walls about our life were brass impregnable, and humored thus, comes at the last and with a little pin, bows through his causal wall, and farewell king, cover your heads and mock not flesh and blood, with solemn reverence throw away respect, tradition, form, and ceremonious duty, for you have but mistook me all this while. I live with bread like you, feel want, taste grief, need friends, subjected thus. How can you say to me, I am a king? Let's see the paraphrase. Let's talk of graves, of worms and epitaphs. As King Richard II is in a critical position, that's in a hopeless condition, he cannot speak of comforts. Hence, he talks about graves, worms, and epitaphs. Here, grave means the burial place for the dead. Epitaphs means the inscriptions or carvings or writings on tombstones in memory of the dead. Make dust o'er paper and with rainy eyes write sorrow on the bosom of the earth. Being dethroned from the political control of England, he desperately realizes the mortality of the kings. Here he compares dust with paper and rainy eyes with writing instruments. He wants to write with the rainy eyes on the earth. Rainy eyes means he is sorrowful. Bosom means chest. Let's choose executors and talk of wills, and yet not so. For what can we bequeath? Say our deposed bodies to the ground. King Richard II is at the height of desperation and laments his situation with his thoughts. Here he requests his men to choose their executors, to carry out their terms of will into effect, because all of them have to leave their deposed bodies to the ground. Our lands, our lives, and all are boiling brooks, and nothing can we call our own but death. In the previous line, he talked about will. But in this line, he speaks of how his lands, lives, and everything belong to Bolingbroke, and nothing can be called his own except death. And the small model of the barren earth, which serves as paste and cover to bones, he regrets that the only thing that can be passed on to their descendants is their deposed bodies. The small model refers to the little patch of the earth that covers the body after death. For God's sake, let's sit upon the ground and tell sad stories of the deaths of kings. He utterly gives up and consents to sit on the floor and tell stories of the deaths of kings, In these lines, King Richard II wants the future generations to know how the kings were deposed or killed for their power and royalty. How some have been deposed, some slain in war, some haunted by the ghosts they have deposed, some poisoned by their wives, some sleeping killed. He recollects from his memory the sad plight of the murdered kings, how some have been deposed, how some have been slain in war, how some have been haunted by the ghost of the kings they deposed, how some have been poisoned by their wives, and how some have been killed in sleep. All murdered, for within the hollow crown that rounds the mortal temples of a king, all kings were killed in order to capture their crowns. The crowns were nothing but hollow or empty in the middle, and thereby denote that the power is not solid, strong or permanent. There's always death around the kings, and there is no way to escape. Keith's death is scored, and there the antic sits, scoffing his state and grinning at his pomp. Here Richard II personifies death as a court jester. Death sits within the crown and laughs at king's reign and mocks at his great ceremonies. Antic means the court jester. Scoffing means expression of mockery. Grinning means smiling wildly. Allowing him a breath, a little scene, to Manoches, be feared and kill with looks. Here the court jester grants the kings the temporary license to live a little while and to Manoches, and then to live in fear and get killed. Manoches means to rule over, carrying out the duties and functions of the king, infusing him with self and vain conceit, as if this flesh which walls about our life were brass, impregnable, and humored thus. Death fills the mortal kings with useless pride, as if the flesh that covers their bodies is immune to, or proof against attack, as if the king's body is immortal, its being ridiculed. Comes at the last, and with a little pin. Here King Richard II tells his followers the ultimate end of a king on the earth. Even though a king can monarchize the entire world, or his province as he aspires, his rule will be only for a short period of time. Death comes to the king at the end and takes his life away all of a sudden. Death bids farewell to the king. Bows through his causal wall and farewell king. Death is like a little pin pierced through the causal wall of the king's life, and with a little effort kills the body and bids farewell. It's the fate of everybody irrespective of the position or power. It's clear that nobody can be spared from death, including the powered kings. Cover your heads and mock not flesh and blood. With solemn reverence, throw away respect, tradition, form and ceremonious duty. At last, he appeals to his followers to protect their heads and not to mock at his mere flesh and blood. By showing reverence and respect to him, he pleads them to throw away the respect, tradition and formal duties towards the royal state, as everything is discorded with the defeat of the king. For you have but mistook me all this while. Richard II tells his followers that they were wrong about him all the time. There's no need to pretend that he is different from them. I live with bread like you, feel want, taste grief, need friends, subjected thus. He establishes that he and his subjects are equal in the end, because he feels all the same as they do. He also needs bread to live, feels want, taste grief and needs friends. Further, both are going to meet with death. How can you say to me, I am a king? At the end of his speech, Richard II questions his subjects how they could call him as their king, since he was compelled to recognize human mortality. He realizes that the truth and wisdom had suddenly dawned on him. King Richard II philosophizes life in common, which has to be ended up one day naturally. Here King Richard II's character echoes Shakespeare's other plays. How can you say to me I am a king? The last line is a rhetorical question. As King Richard II makes a point to elicit an answer, this interrogative statement drives home a point rather than eliciting an answer. I hope you have enjoyed the video. Thank you for watching. Like, share and comment. Do subscribe Magellan Magell Academy.